Assuming I'm rooting for everybody that's black. Yeah. Assuming I'm rooting for everybody that's black.
Yeah. Before we jump into introducing our special guest, as you know, we're sponsored and powered by a lot of black-owned businesses in the area. So first and foremost, we want to start with On God Motivation. We're sponsored by OnGodMotivation.com. Check out the site. Positive motivational apparel. It's from Faith Meets Fashion.
Faith Meets Fashion.
Check us out on GodMotivation.com. Shop today. We got some spring merch that dropped. Also with some fall
winter on the way.
Stuff is on the way as well.
So that's right.
Check out the site today. Also, we're sponsored by the Woody Foundation, a nonprofit organization that does a lot of great things in the community. Our first Fridays are at Diversity Center. Check us out on thewoodyfoundation.org. We got a lot of things going on in the community and a lot of events coming up. So support the mission, be a part of that. Also, we're sponsored by First Choice Transportation. It's a black-owned transportation company out of Richmond, Virginia. Check us out at firstchoicetransportationva.com for all valet, parking, events, concerts, chauffeur service as well. We offer everything under the tree. Just hit the contact us section in the on the website, and we'll reach back to you within 48 hours.
Make first choice.
Make first choice.
Your first choice.
All right, now with all the business and formal stuff out of the way, I want to introduce our special guest today. We have Senator, correct?
Yes, sir.
Senator Lamont Bagby with us today. How you doing, sir?
Blessed.
All
good
right.
To see you. Good to see you.
Thank you for joining us
Absolutely.
Today. The reason we created this podcast is because we wanted to promote positive conversation
right.
in the community. Because you know, if you see online, a lot of stuff is negative, a lot of stuff is pushed in, you know, clickbait and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
We kind of wanted to shift the trajectory out there in the world and put more positivity out in that space. So we talked to business owners, we talked to politicians, we talked to everybody, and mainly our conversations surround around things in the community. So we're going to touch on some things, but we also like to dive into who the person is. Who the person is behind the business, behind the names, behind the title. So
right.
we're gonna dive into a little bit of all of that, who you are, who's the person, what makes you tick, why you decide to get into politics.
Mm-hmm.
And we're gonna touch on some personal things, sports, music, you know, some things to kind of
50 years of hip hop.
Yeah. 50 years of hip hop, a lot of things going on. So we just wanna say thank you for taking the time out
sure.
to speak with us today. So Keith, you got anything you want to kick off with my brother Lamont, since y'all kind of went to school together?
Yeah.
Got some history there.
Yeah, same. You know, yeah. Right, go alumni.
That's right.
You know,
right.
But I just want to thank you again just for coming on, man, and supporting and just telling us about yourself. Because a lot of people really don't get that from podcasts, like you were saying.
Sure.
You get the tea and all that stuff, man.
Mm-hmm.
We're a whole type different podcast,
yeah.
you know. So I appreciate you taking the time and putting your schedule together for us.
Yeah. So first and foremost, I want to jump off and just ask,
right.
what made you, being a African-American brother from the city, what made you want to get into politics?
Well, it started off serving as a teacher at Henrico High School,
okay.
and then going on to be an assistant principal over at Fairfield Middle School.
Wow.
And I decided to run for school board after that.
Gotcha.
And so that's what got me into public service, public education. And that started off of our experiences in, for me, Laburnum, Moody, and mm-hmm. Henrico, and not seeing enough black men in that space.
Yeah.
And so when I went to Nova State, I majored in business.
Wow. Okay.
But then I called home to one of my mentors, Bill Parker, to share with him that I didn't really think that was a role for me. I didn't see myself just being full-time business. I couldn't figure out, like, that space for me. I wanted to do something more in public service.
Right.
Okay. And so he suggested teaching. I came back and taught at Henrico High School. And then, like I said, went over to Fairfield Middle School, ran for office, accidentally won.
I like that.
And then you know, the Senate, after serving 8 years on the school board, the House of Delegates seat became available. And I ran for it. And won that seat as well. And from then, I served 8 years there.
Wow. Okay.
Six of that serving as the chair of the Virginia Legislative Black Caucus. And now I serve as the Virginia Legislative Black Caucus chair in the Senate.
I love it.
Hmm. So what did that 8 years look like? Like, how
Which eight? So it's been eight in the school system,
uh-huh.
eight as a school board member, and then eight as
a
delegate.
Yeah, Which is?
So the final, not the final eight, but the House of Delegates.
The House of Delegates, well, that
was kind of different coming from the school system.
Yeah, well, it's broader. So you have an opportunity to make a impact on the entire Commonwealth. Mm-hmm. And you start focusing on issues that you might, you know, I never thought about. I never thought about the environment as much as I did now.
Right.
I carry legislation related to electric vehicles, which became the biggest piece of legislation that year for the environmentalists, like the League of Conservation Voters and Sierra Club. Mm-hmm. I carry legislation related to voting rights. We have public education in you know, working in the school system.
Yeah.
I wasn't focused on voting rights. I carried legislation that kicked payday lenders out of the Commonwealth.
Mm.
And so you see the check and cash in all those places.
Right.
You don't see them as much anymore.
Not really.
Because they had interest rates at 400% plus.
Right.
And we put a cap on that. And so they couldn't operate their businesses. And so those loan sharks are gone. Those are pieces of legislation that, you know, growing up where I'm from, and even working in the system that I was in Henrico, I really wasn't thinking about those things.
Mm-hmm.
But when you listen to your constituents and try to get to the root problems of what's going on out here, then you start thinking about healthcare and housing along with education.
Yeah, and it's great that you kind of touched on all those things, because I think as men or as adults, right, as we grow up, we shift our priorities, right, of what's important. And that's great to know, because I think a lot of us as young men or as young people, young adults, we don't think about a lot of these things, right? Like, I wasn't thinking about the planet, right? I wasn't thinking about these things, but as you get older, these become priorities.
It's a top priority, yeah.
So it's good to hear, one, that you are not only in the position and then just making your own things that you think need to be changed, but you're also listening to your people that are
sure.
on the ground.
And make it smarter.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes people come to me with pieces of legislation that's sort of far out or I know won't get passed.
Mm-hmm.
And I explain to them, hey, if we want to just get this to the masses and make sure people are aware of it, we can put this legislation out.
Yeah.
But if you want to actually get something passed, let's think about how we can work across party lines sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
But recently we had the House, the Senate, and the Governor's Mansion as Democrats. And so we were able to get a lot passed related to not only the bills I just named, mm-hmm. but also with public safety. That was a big one. We were able to get a lot passed. We were able to give some relief to individuals with housing, particularly when we were in the pandemic.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so we were able to do a lot with healthcare. And so when you know, sometimes you have to work across party lines, but if folks do what they need to do at the on election day, we can get things done
right. And is that
throughout.
And is that a, because that's one thing that I noticed, right? When it's not, as they call it, the local elections, right? I noticed that we don't get the participation on that level as we do in the for the presidential, right?
Right.
And for me, I'm trying to look at a way to how we can educate people to understand, right? If you want to make changes or get things put into place, that's where you're voting, right? Because a lot of times when we vote for the president, the people like governors, all those are already in place, right? So you're skipping over the actual process that affects your state. And what would you say you would like to see more people participate in that, the local election? And what do you see could help that? Like, help more people come out and want to be a part of
it. It's one of those things where we just can't give up. We can't give up on folks, and we just got to keep on trying to get folks engaged.
Do you think it's a lack of information?
It is a lack of information. I mean, it's also it costs money to speak to voters. Just one mailer in my district costs about $20,000.
Wow.
In a smaller district, a house district, it costs about $8,000 to send out a mailer. And so when you send out a mailer, most elected officials send out the mailer to those that have already voted before.
Mm-hmm.
You look at who's voted in the last three elections,
right,
and you send it out to them. because you don't want to waste your money on individuals that don't vote. But at the same time, I think it's our duty to try to expand our universe. We call it the universe, to make sure that we are speaking to more people and getting out into spaces where individuals don't vote as much.
Gotcha. And that's really the reason why we kind of created this platform, is to highlight that, right? Because a lot of times, see me, I was raised in a family where we knew what was happening, right? So I knew to vote during the local elections as well as the president, mm-hmm. right? I knew that, you know, if I didn't get in contact with somebody about the school board, you contact the school board, right? You know, but everybody doesn't have that information. Mm-hmm. And this is why we kind of created this platform, is to share this type of information out. Because again, like you said, it costs you all on one end, and then you don't know who you're sending to. Like you said, it could be a thing where, because I know it happens to me all the time. You get mail, they come heavy. Sometimes I don't look at it. Sometimes I throw it away, I keep it moving. Mm-hmm. So I think these, if we have more of these conversations, promote these, I think that will help push people to the local election side.
Yeah, and we've done things to make voting easy. We did that when we had the majorities. We have the drop boxes, we have the mail-in, we have 45 days of voting, so there's no way in the world you're going to ever stand in line in the Commonwealth of Virginia, because as you know, the Black Caucus push for a number of things to make voting easier and safer in the Commonwealth, and that legislation is still intact today. So voting starts 1 month mm-hmm. from today. Mm-hmm. That early voting starts 1 month from today. And so there's no reason why folks shouldn't be out voting. We just need to make sure that they understand that early voting is available and it's easy. And I also have a piece of legislation that gave localities the authority to do Sunday voting. Mm-hmm. Henrico and Richmond aren't taking advantage of it this year, but we're going to put pressure on them to come take on, advantage on it on, in
Richmond.
The future.
Yeah. Tighten up, Richmond. That's right. Because I think that's a great option, because I know a lot of the issues that people run into is work, mm-hmm. right? I'm scheduled to work that day, and I'm blessed to have a job where if you voted there, you can go and you can vote. So that, but you do have some people that they're restricted to. They got to go to work, and then they make the polls. And like you said, they think it's just that day. No, it's not. You can vote, like you said, a month from now. Mm-hmm. You can start voting.
Right when you get out of church.
45 days. Yep.
Yeah, straight out of church. You want to go.
And
oh, I like that.
So was there any hesitation coming from the school system to?
I was, I don't know if y'all know Roscoe Cooper, but he also went to Henrico. He took my place on the school board. Mm-hmm. And so I used to visit schools almost daily. And now I don't get that opportunity. Yeah. And so yesterday, the first day of school, I had an opportunity to visit some schools with him.
Okay.
Glenn Lee, Laburnum, Wilder, Henrico. And that's what I miss, being, especially when I went to Henrico, mm-hmm. I miss being in a school community, watching young people grow and seeing them come in ninth grade and mature to be seniors and go to college or to the military or to the workforce, and then seeing also teachers and administrators grow.
And
still to this day, those teachers and administrators that either taught me while I was in Henrico or worked alongside of me in Henrico or Fairfield, follow my political career,
right?
Because the bond is so tight.
Wow.
So I miss that. Yeah. You know, I mean, we build a different camaraderie with individuals in the General Assembly and in the public service sphere, but being with those folks day in and day out, it was special.
Right.
So as you know. Got to kind of touch on this because it's been a hot topic in the news. What do you feel about our former President Trump and all his indictments and all of that stuff that's happening? Because he's the first president.
Yeah, I've been trying to leave that Fox News and CNN and MSNBC alone. And that's been since probably Trump's second year of service. It just way too much. And it was less focused on what we were doing for people and more about him. And I think he has it in his mind, as well as our current governor. They have it in their mind where they're just going to pile on. And so you forget he said grab him by the, you forget that he said he can go and shoot somebody. You forget about all that because he just, every week, every couple of days, it's something else that he piles on. And so I will say this, out of all the charges that he's faced with, the one of our him I'll be most afraid of is the one in Georgia.
Yeah.
Because she ain't nobody to play it with.
Right.
She's not playing.
No. I tell you, she is not one to play with. And she is the queen of the RICO charge. And so once she dropped that on him, I said, that's the one. And it's not a federal charge, it's a state. So it's a tough one.
Yeah, I just like you touched on, and I'm glad you kept it short because I didn't want to go too much into it, but I do think that it's taken away from what's important, right? What we should be focusing on as a country, right? Yeah. We're literally spending, I'm sure, millions trying to lock the former president up. And I think right now in this current election, we need to be focused on the actual issues that we should be talking about in the elections.
But they tie, it's one of those things where they're tying law enforcement's hand. They say they are supportive of law enforcement, but there's no way you can allow what happened on January 6th and between November, that November election and January 6th. There's no way you can let that happen because if you let that happen, then that becomes the norm.
Yep.
And people will run up in state capitals and in courtrooms across the nation because we allowed that moment to happen. Mm-hmm. And so while it costs the Commonwealth and the nation and D.C. a lot of money to find all those folks and hold them accountable, it's something that I think we had to do.
Oh, I definitely think
But it's unfortunate that we have to spend those times, those resources, congressional hearings on something such as that when we have so many other issues that we could be tackling.
Now, I'm sure you know what's going on in Florida with Governor DeSantis and education stuff, and that's something that education is big for me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think, and I believe, I don't know, but I don't think Virginia's going in that direction as far as trying to change education.
Oh, no, our governor is working really hard. Anything he sees DeSantis do, he does. And so he's been trying really hard. So this is the year that this past year was the year that we were, as a Commonwealth, scheduled to redo our history curriculum. And so our governor, our previous governor, had worked with numerous groups, from the NAACP to the Jewish community, the AAPI, Asian community, so many communities, communities of faith, to make sure that it was inclusive.
Of course. Yeah.
And it was honest and truthful.
Mm-hmm.
When Governor Youngkin came in, he threw that in the trash. Wow. And had a team of individuals that he brought from out of state to draft. And they did a horrible job.
Wow.
And so we as a Black Caucus and other organizations across the Commonwealth, NAACP and others, demanded that they do better.
Gotcha.
And so the board at the time also demanded that they do better.
Yeah.
But since then, he has had more of his board members push for his form of his version. And so we're still working on that.
Gotcha.
As you know, he wants to take a number of books out of the schools. Mm-hmm. And a lot of those books are reflective of the honesty and the pain that African Americans endured in this nation. And we can't have that. In his version, he had nothing about Barack Obama, but he had Ronald Reagan in there. And so I don't think in 100 years from now, you're going to be thinking about Ronald Reagan as much as you're going to think about the first African American president in the nation.
Yeah, and to me, we can't rob our state of our history.
Yeah.
Right? Positive or negative, right? It's the history
it's real history.
Virginia. Right? And for me being a born and raised here in Virginia, I do understand our history. So when I hear you trying to change it or amend it.
Or make it cute and say
We benefited from it.
But it's no is an accountability factor too. They don't want to take accountability for that history.
Because part of me kind of feels that way is like if you teach the younger other races about this, they may question
mm-hmm.
some of their elders. Well, why was this acceptable? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And I think that's what they're trying to eliminate because the younger generation aren't raised like we were, right? You know, we were kind of segregated to a certain degree if you were born in a certain era. But now you go to school with everybody. So there's no, like I said, a kid from the first time they go to school, they're going to school with Asians, Black, all these backgrounds. So you can't separate. And I think if I take the history out, mm-hmm. now it's we all kumbaya, we all peaceful.
Yeah, and I think it's about respect of how each of us end up in the space that we are. And with full understanding that no one in that room is responsible for it.
Yeah.
But you have to respect history in order for it. If you want it to repeat itself, then you know how to make it repeat itself.
Exactly.
If you don't want it to happen again, then you know how to prevent it. And so I think when we talk about history, we have a responsibility to make sure that it's actual and factual.
Yeah. Yeah. So is there any, so I guess my other question would be, because I just found out I'm a part of the Reform Alliance that Meek Mill, Jay-Z, and all of them started, and I just found out about either amending or putting a new law in place.
Mm-hmm.
How does that work?
So we've had a couple of Reform Alliance meetings here in this space we're in right now. With the attorneys for Meek Mill. Mm-hmm. And then one of my colleagues, Don Scott, who has been a real champion for reform in the Commonwealth, has conducted some meetings with the attorneys here. And also when Governor Northam signed his legislation, and Meek Mills was here, that was a pretty cool moment. But in order to get legislation, the first thing you want to do is start with an idea. It's like a business. You start with the idea, you present the idea to either my legislative staff or myself or another member's legislative staff, and we begin crafting the legislation, working with legislative services in the General Assembly. And at that point, we flush it out. We let other members of the community take a look at it. If it's, let's say it's a piece of legislation that focuses on earn sentence credit.
Okay.
Where you earn some earn time off.
Okay.
All right. So you have 20 years, and the course of your time served, you have earned 3.5 years.
Okay.
And we want to reformulate that.
Okay.
And so we may say that we want to talk to the correctional facilities. We might want to talk to the parole board. We might want to talk to the Department of Corrections. We might want to talk to other legislators, reform, mm-hmm. other members of the community. So to see how to really flesh this out and what are the unintended consequences for it, mm-hmm. or we're looking at the right level. And so that's what we would do. And then we'll go forward with introducing the legislation. And that legislation will first go before the subcommittee and then the committee. And then it goes to the floor of both houses, the House and the Senate, and then it goes to the governor.
Oh, wow. Okay. So there is a process.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it all starts out with the idea and getting a number of people together on the front end so that when you're presenting your bill, you don't have a lot of people getting up and opposing it.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
And if you and if they are opposing it, you at least know how to rebuttal whatever issues or concerns that they may have.
Gotcha. Okay.
So just because you're talking to all of them doesn't mean they're going to agree with you.
Oh, yeah.
But at the same time, it's worth the conversation early.
That was going to be my question. How does the cooperation, when it gets to the end point, when it goes to, you know, before it gets to the final stages, is the cooperation most of the time everybody's on the same page, or
is it what we see when the house is split?
Yeah.
No, I think most of the times it's there's not initial agreement.
Right.
But then I also think, you know, you get to another 50% of individuals that will find some compromise. And then you have another 25% of the time where, like raising the minimum wage, when we raised the minimum wage, you know, there was a 25% of folks that were just like adamantly opposed.
Right.
Really?
We got no Republican votes for that.
Wow. Really?
For raising the minimum wage.
I would have thought they would have been on board for that.
They were on board with us giving millionaires and billionaires tax breaks, but they are not on board with raising the minimum wage, and so we've done that. We've got it to $12, but we need to get it to 15 sooner than later.
So is it so the July 1, 2024 isn't set yet for the minimum wage to go up?
It's set for 12.
Okay, so it's not set to go to 15 yet.
No.
Oh, I thought it was set to go. To
15. No, no. So we have what's called a reenactment.
Okay.
So reenactment means you have to really vote, come back and vote on it again.
Gotcha. Okay. So that'll be another one. Yeah. Probably be
and right now we're split. So if we were to vote on it again, it would fail because the Republicans in the House would not vote for it. Now we have an opportunity in November to win both the House and the Senate. And if we win both the House and the Senate, then we can reenact.
Okay. So I mean, get out and vote, man.
That's yeah.
Right. Get out and vote. Y'all want to make that $15 minimum wage a possibility. Yeah.
You got the power to do it.
And I think that goes back to what we touched on in the beginning is participation, right? Like we, as much as you all want to do, mm-hmm. you need the participation of the people, right? The people sure. have to come out and vote on these things to get passed so you yeah. all can make sure it gets
Yeah, and we're talking about raise up thin margins.
Yeah, because to me, I think 15 is doable.
Yeah, well, what I'm speaking of raise up thin margins is in the House we have 100 members.
Okay.
52 of them are Republicans at this time, and 48 of them are Democrats. In the Senate, it's reverse. We have 40 members, and we have 22 of them that are Democrats, and 18 of them who are Republicans. Mm. And so this thing can flip either way.
Mm.
How difficult is it when it's split like that to get something done? Because I've seen it in the past where when they're on separate sides, it's almost impossible.
Yeah, some folks like it to be that way because only things that both parties agree upon gets done. Right. But if you are looking at it through the lens, I've been looking at it through the lens, the people that I want to help the most don't oftentimes the benefit of that,
right.
Because I feel like there are millionaires and billionaires aren't asking for these rebates, don't need these rebates, are feeling really good about where we are as it relates to the economy, mm-hmm. but there's some real individuals out here hurting at the same time,
yeah.
and they need us to take care of their public schools, they need us to take care of the roads,
yeah.
they need us to take care of the correctional facilities, they need us to take care of the healthcare facilities,
yes.
They need us more than ever. While yeah. those individuals that are well off are well off,
yeah. right. and they're straight.
Yeah, and we're not talking about raising their taxes or taking anything from them. They can continue on with business as usual,
yeah.
but we don't need to send them thousands of dollars back.
No, I think that's crazy.
Crazy. Absolutely crazy.
I want to touch on the current housing issue that's going on in the city. Are you involved with that, or is there any plan in place to kind of address the current housing issue that's going on in the city?
Well, there's some real opportunities for us to work together, not only on the local level in the state level, on the federal level, but also bringing RRHA into the fold and working collaboratively. We have done some things collaboratively, but we have not exhausted all of the tools that we have in the toolbox. RRHA, I hope they present a plan, and not a plan just for the city, but a plan for the region that includes Henrico, Chesterfield. Because it's a real opportunity out there for us to not have saturation of poverty in pockets of Richmond or Henrico.
Right.
They're,
it just seems like it's going up.
Yeah. Because we talk about redlining as if it was something from the 60s and the 70s, but we have redlining right now. Local officials know that they can't go but so far west with subsidized housing.
Gotcha.
And we can't have that. We have to make sure that we are allowing individuals in every community, particularly when we build up new communities like Manchester and Scott's Addition, that we are incorporating some subsidized housing into that. Because if we don't, we will end up with saturated poverty and individuals that aren't able to feed off of the positivity that is going on in other parts of the Commonwealth. And and I'm not just speaking of Richmond.
I literally have a friend out in Henrico who he's working to try to, you know, help as much as possible. But like you said, like it's so much. It's only one that a individual can do, right? It's going to take a group effort and a team effort. Right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Collaborative effort. Right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, on that note, let's take a quick break.
It breaks my heart. They ain't believing us. We the best music. They play themselves. While you hating and being jealous, you could be over here embracing that love. More love, more blessings, more life. God did. You either win with us or you watch us.
The Informal Podcast. All right, thank you, sir. First half, a wonderful, great conversation.
A lot of information.
So if you didn't know, watch it, learn it back.
That's right.
Be a part of the change. Be a part of the change. All right, so got all the political stuff out of the way. Now I want to touch on who Lamont Bagby is as a person, a father, how your father, your cousin, all that good stuff. So I'm going to touch on all of that good stuff. You know, this past year was the 50-year hip hop, and I'm sure you were raising a culture a lot of us was. How old are you, Lamont?
46.
All right, so you are a hip hop baby. Definitely. Like, everybody
is a hip hop baby.
So,
80s baby.
What was hip hop to you growing up, and how important was it to see hip hop reach 50 years?
The 50-year thing, you know, it's cool, but I think it's only cool because people are doing cool things around it.
Okay.
But like, just turning 50 doesn't mean much to me. But just like everything from like, I think the biggest thing that happened was the Book of Hope, we're gonna go see at the end of September.
Me and the White
House. I mean, you know, he is that guy, and so I took her to see Beyonce. You know, we're gonna go see Book of Hope. That's my thing. And so thinking about and rewinding, like when I was a real youngster in Essex Village, and we used to. I was like, my brother and I, we had a big boom box. And everybody wanted us to bring our boom box out because they were bringing out the cardboard.
That's right.
And, you know, we got our music from like Report WKIE. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, I know all those guys. Matter of fact, I just took a picture at an event this weekend with Boney. I don't know if you remember Boney, but Boney had Boone. And then Mike B, who had, you know, his classic record,
Funk Motor.
And so, you know, those guys, I don't think they really understand because they show me so much love now because of the three summons. But I'm like, man, y'all are my heroes before y'all.
Right? Yeah.
Before I knew who I was. And so seeing them and then, like, you know, spending time with the late, great Joe Dozier, who was my guy.
Yeah, R.I.P. Dozier.
And then I was just on the phone before I came here with Lonnie, because he's taking his daughter to, Lonnie B is taking his daughter to ODU, and my son is going to ODU today.
Oh, wow.
Nice. So congratulations.
And, you know, Lonnie and Danger and I are a trio of friends. And just knowing that, just knowing the, how hip hop has grown and the space that hip hop has moved in. And even in my role now, I've been fortunate to spend some time with some other Virginian hip hop artists like Pharrell and Pusha, and getting to know them and them getting to know my priorities. We've worked on some real projects together.
Yeah,
some we can't talk about because we don't want to put folks out there. Because it was about helping people. It wasn't about getting notoriety. And so seeing the passion, particularly that Pharrell had for some stuff that was actually going on in Richmond. We all know what the fashion that he had for Virginia Beach and his cousin. But, you know, there was some stuff that was going on in Richmond that he called me and said, I heard about this, let's make it happen.
Right.
And we did what we had to do to make it happen. And so the thing about hip hop is it started out as a set of music, a little graffiti and those arts, but now it's just in us. It's just a way of life.
It's a culture.
It's the culture. Like a culture. And I'm glad you touched on all that, because that's what people from Richmond or Virginia, our view of music is different, right? From, like you say, so by you naming the local artists, the, you know, artists that may not had the mainstream success, but they still play a part of it, right? Because it's crazy that you mentioned Lonnie Bennett, because Super Friends was like that group that I thought, oh, word, like we really got a group of guys who can rap, you know what I mean?
Who can rap?
Like really rap, you know what I mean? And so I was proud of them, and not because they were just from our area, but like you said, I knew Danger Mouth. Danger Mouth was a substitute teacher, he's a substitute teacher, you know what I'm saying? Like Lonnie B, I actually rapped battle against Lonnie B when I was 16, because he came to the school, you know what I'm saying? So it's just, I think that culture, like you said, it's in us. It's not just a fashion. It's not just what you do. It's in us.
Way of life.
It's a way of life, man.
And I think it's right here in Richmond. Like, a lot of stuff is going on that people have no idea about. Like, I went to the, I don't know if y'all know that Mayor Stoney pretty much confirmed that, I forgot what day it was. It was the Rapper's Delight that I went to. Big Noah, all them. And he declared that Hip Hop Day in Richmond.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? That was big. You know, he had Mike Street there, and Mike Street read it off, and it was big. It was major.
I co-wrote that, by the way.
You co-wrote that?
Yeah, you think
that was pretty good.
The mess from Hampton Roads, he don't know those names. I had to give him those names. Come on, man.
Yeah.
You had to get
some Richmond flavor on it. Well, I get it.
I love seeing it, right? I love seeing that the mayor and the senator are working together on things for our community.
Oh yeah, no question.
I think that's beautiful.
No question.
And then again, they're tying in, yes, we're on this side of the fence, you're on this side of the week coming down.
Yeah, but it also is respect, a mutual respect for him and I, where he knows what I know and I know what he knows, and we can feed off that.
Yeah.
And so, but hip hop is, I mean, I go back and forth from looking at what's going on in the hip hop world to the political world. And then when I need a break from it all, I just watch Family Feud. But that's my two worlds, man.
Yeah.
You know, that's my two worlds. And it's awesome when those two worlds can collide. And, you know, when somebody in the hip hop sphere that's really in the hip hop sphere wants to come and do something in the political field. One of the other things is like the film industry.
Mm-hmm.
The film industry is an industry that we can do much better at.
Wow.
In the Commonwealth, we have all of the things that people want mm-hmm. as relates to the structures and the spaces and the mountains and the woods and
yep.
historical
and
spots,
and historical
everything.
Buildings
yeah.
for folks who want to film here. But we don't have the tax credits to make sure mm-hmm. that we're taking advantage of it like a land.
Oh.
And so one of the things we did was with, matter of fact, for rail there, that mission, some of us went down to look at Tyler Perry's studio, which is phenomenal,
yeah.
and a couple of other studios in Atlanta.
Right.
And those folks are able to do that because of the tax credits.
Mm.
And then they bring in so much money.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember when watching something on, I think, a YouTube or something, where they were doing a little video where I think it was Bad Boy 2 coming to America and something else all shooting on Time Perry Studio.
Oh, yeah, yeah, all that.
Yeah. Mm. And so, like, man, we could get some of that energy here. He was a producer of, and folks don't know, was a producer. Pharrell was a producer of Hidden Figures.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Which was
yeah.
a, so you have a Virginia story.
Yeah.
Wow.
Shot in Atlanta.
Oh yeah.
Mm.
No, and it's crazy that you said that because I've been blessed to kind of work in the film industry here, right? And we've had shows like Swagger, you know, they're filmed here, but it's like what you said, right? We literally have all of the looks, the space,
yeah.
And whether that's, and I think now we're starting to get the TV shows. I would love, like you said, to get the actual film production, the movie side of it, because I do believe Virginia has a lot to offer,
mm-hmm.
a lot to offer. So is that something that you all are working on as far as like those tax credits? And, you know,
well, we have been working on it under Governor Northam's administration. We lost our footing when we lost the mansion.
Gotcha.
When we lost the government.
And that's something young is not even.
I haven't had any conversation with him about it.
Gotcha.
Other people might be coming to him about it, but I haven't.
So what's at the top of your list right now to tackle?
Yeah, what are some things you want to get?
Housing is one thing that I hope that we can really do something about.
Right.
And I think the first thing is you look at how much housing do you need? Where can you put it?
Mm-hmm.
And then we think about what do we need to build and what do we need to restore. I'm not a fan of having subsidized housing on the outskirts of the city. I think we need to bring that those homes inside of the city. They're cutting down on the amount of transportation we need. It also gives them access to resources, wraparound resources, libraries, schools,
jobs,
all those things that we need. I don't think we need to build things just for one population. We need to make sure that the population is invited in spaces that everyone is in.
Yeah.
And so housing is at the top, but we have to also, that's where also we look at incentives. We need to provide incentives for individuals to build, and we need to build up. That's one of the things that's important to me, and I think we can tackle it faster if we build up. You all know what quote-unquote projects look like in Richmond.
Mm-hmm.
There's a bunch of flats,
yeah.
and they take up a lot of land.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
But you see what they build in Manchester and Scottsdale. They're going all the way up. And so that's what we need to do, and we need to make sure that those buildings have different levels of individuals as it relates to economics in each of those buildings.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you have a building where there's 250 units, then you gotta have 100 of those at market rate, 150 of those that we put in percentages. And so those are the type of things that I hope we really consider and build smart.
Gotcha. So are you working with any groups right now or any private groups? Or are there private groups that can get involved with that, or is that something y'all looking for?
Well, what we're looking for are RRHA to take the lead.
Gotcha.
Because they're the custodials of most of the funding.
Gotcha.
And we will funnel most of the funding through them, whether it's state money, or federal money. And I think it's really the opportunity for the state to come in and provide some money related to infrastructure, particularly underground infrastructure.
Yeah.
So if we're going to be doing something for the name of community, but I don't want to give it away too much. Because we're going to do something, not that crazy. Everybody talks about crazy.
Mm-hmm.
If we're going to do something crazy, then that may require running new pipes, running new mm-hmm. lines underground, and getting the infrastructure prepared for the building, which would take a humongous bite out of the cost associated with those buildings. And so those are the things that I think that we can do with federal and state money.
So, other than housing, is there anything else that's kind of on that list, like a 2 or 3?
Well, education is always going to be at the top of my list. And sometimes I don't talk about it because I feel like it's supposed to be no brainer for me. But education is at the top of the list. We need parents to do more. And we need to do a fine job in RICO, I believe, of renovating and replacing schools. But we need to make sure that we have systematic planning, capital improvement plans across the Commonwealth, not just for those school districts that are well managed and have resources, but also those smaller localities that may not oftentimes have the resources. And we need to figure out how we get our students excited about public service. And public service doesn't just mean running for office or working in administration. Public services, first responders, public services, teaching. Those are the things we need to get our students excited about earlier. But the way to get them excited about it is preparing them academically and then also helping them through, helping them get the education that they need to seek those jobs. And then making those jobs attractive by not funding those positions.
Yeah, because I mean, me personally, being a child of public school system, watching how it's kind of changed over the years, I don't think they're setting these kids up to succeed. You know, they're not prepping them for life, right? Like you said, they're not teaching skills anymore. There's, you know, so I think we need to put, like you said, make those jobs fun again, right? Because I remember back in the day, you knew a electrician who made the money. You knew a, you know, guy who made HVAC that made the money, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think, like you said, now they have those jobs, not saying that they're not attractive, but it's not being promoted. Right, it's just go to school, go to college, get a degree. And a lot of times people go to school and end up in debt and don't end up working in the field that they're in. So I think I do want to see more of the trades and different skills pushed towards the kids. So that way, oh, I don't want to do that. I can go do this. I can be an electrician and still be on the ball if that's what you want.
There's more ideas that I'm not ready to let go just yet. Yeah. But even when you start talking about the trades the alternative to college or the military. I think starting individuals earlier is better.
Yep.
And in RICO, I think they have done a phenomenal job with their CTE program.
That's good.
And the city, I think, is pivoting towards strengthening their CTE program. They had a strong CTE program, but the facility is just fell apart. And I think that right now they're in the process of restoring it. And so we just need to make sure that we encourage them and give them the resources to get it done.
Yeah, because the reason I say that is because with my own daughter, right, up until she got to high school, it was lawyer, you know, that's what she wanted to be. And then the school she goes to, one of the curriculum classes was, thinking and all of that, and then she realized as in that grade, that's not what she wanted to do. So now, dermatology has been a priority, but the school offers CPR, like, so she's been CPR certified, so now she's already kind of, she knows exactly what she wants to do. Like you said, a lot of kids don't figure that out until they get to college.
Right.
When it's that first year, it's like, no, this ain't really what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So I do think if you start them younger,
they
do have a better chance on actually achieving that goal.
Right, you got to give them more information.
And I go with them. I mean, I'm a little different than a lot of other people. I always say go to college. You know, I think one of those things that we pivot so much to like the trades that we're almost saying, huh, why are you going to college? But I think what we want to do is allow them to dream.
Right.
And allow them to go forward with whatever they want to do and just support that dream out. But I always, if college is possible, which I believe for most students, it is, go forward. You know, even with borrowing, I always tell young people, man, go ahead to the program that has raised up every day. So when you graduate, you have your borrowing license. And then when you go to the state, ODU, Virginia State, Virginia U, that's what you know. You make your money by cutting hair.
Y'all
paying your way through college.
And you can actually earn another degree. So then you got multiple skill sets.
It's opportunities out there to do both. I have a gentleman that served in the General Assembly with me. His family had a plumbing company, the Lindsays. But he became a judge. But you know what he knows how to do?
What?
Well, I bet he knew. You still can get on that truck with anybody else and help folks with the plumbing company.
Oh, yeah, because you know we need all the skills we can get. So, boy, you got to wrap up with our guest, Lamont Bagby, Senator. Lamont Bagby, my apologies. So we wrapped up on, we touched on hip hop, some policies, some good stuff. So we're going to wrap up on the main. So I like to ask people, what are some of their proudest personal accomplishments? You can give me one, you can give me two.
Yeah.
But what is some of your proudest personal accomplishments? Not political, but your personal accomplishments, something that you've done.
Well, one would be, you know, my son is headed to ODU, and so getting my children off to college. That's the third one, getting off to college. Two would be becoming getting my honorary doctorate from Virginia Union.
Oh, wow, nice.
You know, earning a bachelor's at Nova State and earning a master's at VCU.
Was
great, but when somebody gives you an honorary and allows you to do speak at the commencement, that speaks volumes. That was a really proud moment for me and my family. And then another one is something I found out about. You know, no one ever called and told me about it, but I was on Facebook one morning the day of elections, and this lady posted a picture of a build of a building, and it looked like it had my name on it. And I zoomed in, and it did have my name on it. And so it was supposed to be a surprise, but it's also a polling place. So the lady said, just voted at the Lamont Bagby Center. And I was like, wow. So they had renamed the community center where I grew up, the Lamont Bagby Center.
Nice.
Oh, and so
big.
So that was cool.
And where what community center? Yeah. Where is
Texas Village? Well, St. Luke now.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Nice. So those were, you know, rise at the top. You know, being named chair of the Virginia Legislative Black Caucus would probably be the fourth. You asked for two on them, you'd be four.
No, you can run
home. But being named the chair of the Virginia Legislative Black Caucus was pretty cool, because I think about who started it. Like people like Governor Wilder and so forth, and even the seat that I sit in now, the 9th Senate District, before me was Jennifer McClellan, folks know that, but then before that it was Donald McEachin, and before that it was Benny Lambert, and before that it was Doug Wilder, and before that it was J. Sergeant Reynolds.
Yo, you in the...
And so, you know, I've been blessed. I've been blessed. And then my wife and I purchased this space. This space was one of the first banks in Richmond. And the gentleman by the name of John Mitchell built this building.
Wow.
And he had the architects build this building in the fashion that he's built. You see the marble around the walls so forth, because it was a bank, and he wanted the black folks to come into the bank to have the same pride that the white folks had across Broad Street when they went to their bank. And as you know, he wasn't the only person around here with a bank. There was another lady around here with a bank, Maggie Walker.
That's right.
And folks don't oftentimes know that Maggie Walker ran for public office. She ran for state superintendent. It was a position called state superintendent at the time. And she ran along with John Mitchell. And John Mitchell was running for governor. And so they wanted to be, at the time, they were Republicans.
Yeah.
And so they wanted to run on the Republican tickets. And the Republicans were like, no. So the Republicans started a Lily White ticket to get the nomination. And so that's why we named it Lily Black, because John Mitchell and Maggie Walker named their ticket the Lily Black ticket.
So what is this building? Is it a?
So this is an event space, and next door, my wife has had a salon.
Okay.
For 12 years.
Wow.
And we purchased this space when it became available 2 years ago.
So not only are you the senator, you are entrepreneur.
Well, she is.
So it's crazy. So the business degree didn't stray too far away.
No. You know, I always have the mind and the desire to do to get in the business sphere, but my passion is public service. And so when it's able to meet, even when at the salon, you know, when we talk about her work at the salon, you know, barbers and hairstylists are oftentimes more so therapists than
therapy,
anything.
Right. Oh, yeah. I know.
Yeah. And so, she has to take a breather when she leaves work because of all the stuff that people pour on her. And that's what I like, man. I like being able to be around people, helping people in whatever we do. And this space right here, I think, not being a bank, but it's also a space where I think John Mitchell should be proud, because this is a place where people meet and enjoy and gather, which is important.
Nice.
Well, look, that's amazing. And one more piece, because you know we've all seen you out and about throughout the city, and I love to see you.
Mm-hmm.
My senators and you know people who represent where I live out in mm-hmm. the community. How important is it for you to just not only be a name, but a face, somebody people can see? I see you at Southern Kitchen. Shout out to my sister Sane.
Mm-hmm.
And I see you out around the people in the community, black businesses. How important is that to you?
Well, I don't know, no different. You know, so I mean, I'm bored at home watching The Family Feud. I really don't know anything different, but you know, I just enjoy being out. You know, I enjoy learning, being around people. You know, I think about the recent events that I've been to, like celebrating the 50th at the Black History Museum,
mm-hmm.
Doing 804 Day. You know, I don't know. I would feel robbed if I missed it.
Yeah.
And then you know.
Always at the AONs.
Literally, I'm sure you hear it. I am one who says it.
Mm-hmm.
We only see the politics of this animal.
Yeah.
And so I think it's great that you're accessible. People walk up to you. Actually, I'm part of a group, New Era RBA, and I mm-hmm. think you met the president.
Yeah. And
you know, she says, oh yeah, I walk up to the mic. It was, you know. And I think that's what we need
mm-hmm.
because that builds those relationships. So you're going back, you know what you're fighting for.
Yeah.
So I think that's
even when you know, we had some back to school events, and I was leaving a back to school event, and you know my brother, and so I'm leaving the event, and someone says, hey, they say Zeke brother, mm-hmm. and I'm like, man, I did all this to earn my name, and I'm still Zeke brother, and the police officers that were walking with us. You know, we're laughing, and she, you know, the young lady started telling us, you know, she's from her, yelling from her porch, a story about my brother, and I'm like, no, this ain't the time. But you know, growing up in the community, you know, is a sense of pride seeing folks, mature, and the fact that she has her own porch, you know, you know, that's cool to me.
And for us. That's why it was important for us to definitely have this conversation with you, because you're a person I've definitely seen out.
Mm-hmm.
Keith told me he actually knows you. I was like, oh yeah, you know, and from everybody I've talked to, it's been, oh,
mm-hmm.
you know, he's a man of his word. He tells you what he can't do or mm-hmm. he can do it. You know, so I just want to say thank you for representing that way.
Right? Yeah.
Because we don't see enough leaders who lead by example. Right. It's a lot of it. I sit behind a desk and bark orders, right?
Yeah.
But I think what you're doing, and this is why I support you, I voted for you, I'm gonna let you know that, because I see what you can possibly do, mm-hmm. right? And, mm-hmm. and I think we need to have more people from our community feel like that, and that's why we wanted to interview you and not just have a political conversation, but get a better understanding, because I think a lot of us understand we're you, mm-hmm. and you can be that if you want to, right? Don't limit yourself based on your circumstances, where you grew up, whether you grew up in Essex or whatever. If that's something you want to do, in public serving and being there for the people is something you want to do, it's possible.
Yeah, and that's what I tell the kids, man. That's something I communicated with the folks at Virginia Union at their graduation is, it's somebody out there waiting for you to take that spot. Oftentimes, there's people out there that's mad or afraid for you to take that spot.
Yep. They know it's coming.
It's somebody waiting for you to take that spot because they don't want somebody that won't value the role to take that spot.
That won't do it.
And I know every spot that I leave, I'm like, man, who's trying to get mm-hmm. this spot? And when I see people that aren't about the work and about the people, mm-hmm. I'm like, man, I cannot let this person get this spot.
Yeah.
All the work I put in this space.
And in this person.
Yeah, and so I've been blessed in the roles that I've had, that the folks that come behind me, whether it's Roscoe Cooper or with my House of Delegates seat, it's going to be Destiny Bowling. Right. I've been blessed to sort of work with those individuals to make sure that they're going to do the job even better than I did.
And you touched on learning and being taught stuff. I want you to give us like a brief kind of sum up of how did the late Donald McEachin affect you
Oh man, you're trying to make me get emotional, man. No, man, that was my guy. I can recall the first time actually talking to him. I already made up my mind I wanted to run for school board, and I wasn't getting a lot of support from people. But I went and talked to him. It was at an MLK event that was actually Virginia Union's annual MLK event.
Okay.
And I asked him for his support and talked to him just for a few minutes. And he gave me his support right there on the spot. And he was my mentor up until the day he died. I spoke at his funeral. He was a real good dude, man. And I can recall having breakfast meetings with him, and then I would bring my buddy Tyrone, and then it ended up us having breakfast every other week. And I can remember his order because he was heavy on the bacon, but then I also remember him eating a lot of popcorn. He was just a regular dude that had done a lot in the community,
right.
Whether it was through the law firm with G or as our delegate and our senator. And so it's been cool to serve in the House seat that he served in and in the Senate seat that he served in. And just a month before he passed away, he had always told me, man, you can't do this alone. You need to find a life partner. And so a month before, he was able to make it to my wedding. Yeah.
Wow. Well, they always say man is on his good as the woman that stands behind him. Right. Or next to him.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what we'll put it. Yeah.
That's
good, man. That's good. Keith, you got anything else?
All I gotta say is I'm proud, bro. I'm proud.
I appreciate it, man.
You know, every time we see each other on the street, it's the same.
It's all love.
Same love.
Well, we want to thank you, Senator Bagby, for joining us.
Yes, sir.
Today.
Yes,
I appreciate the conversation. It was
all right.
Yes, man. I think it was very informative,
mm-hmm.
And I think the people are going to have a lot of information to take from this, and realize nothing is done without the work.
Yeah.
So we just have to.
And working together.
That's right.
Together. Teamwork makes the dream work. So thank you from The Informal Podcast, Spain Like the Country, your boy Big PJR, and I'll get Senator Bagby. Thank you, sir.
All right.
Let's move forward.
Assuming I'm rooting for everybody that's black. Yeah. Assuming I'm rooting for everybody that's black.